Hello, everybody, and welcome to Badgerpod Nerdcast number 48 in Memoriam of Horror Film. I'm your host, Brian Martinez, and I'm joined by the Badgers, my friends, my lovely, lovely friends. Let me introduce to who we have today. I have Hannah Wallen. Say hello, Hannah. I know you have problems with the mute button, right?
Yes.
It's scary.
The keystroke for the mute button, my computer opens up Mac Paint. Or not Mac Paint, but Paint. It opens up Paint.
It's so weird. Apparently, even though you know all the keyboard shortcuts, your computer doesn't.
Yes.
we also have Mr. Randomer Cam.
It's Doctor to you. It's Doctor to anyone. To anyone who's willing to undergo the surgery. Hi, guys.
The surgery?
Excellent.
We have a camera.
Describe the surgery.
And we got Rachel. Rachel, say hi.
Hi, everybody.
Otter Jesus.
Yes, it's me. I'm Otter Jesus.
And Jonathan is our special guest. Jonathan, say hello.
Velkommen in Norwegian.
And Karen left. She was here, and then she wasn't.
I noticed her, and then she got scared.
Well, you know what, though? That might have been Lauren Southern. Because I don't know if you know, but there was that one time we had a show, and Karen logged on, and Lauren Southern's face was on the screen. It was super random.
That's okay. Super creepy.
Yeah, it was creepy. That's a good way to put it. All right, so let's go into the I'll start with the mailbag. And Karen, if you're hearing this and you want to come back in, that's fine. We're talking about horror movies. I hope you know. All right. So Mel has made an inquiry. Have you Badgers been watching the Starz TV series Outlander, which just finished its first season? It features a heroine who was mysteriously whisked back in time from 1945 to 1743. The reason I'm hoping the Badgers address it, if you haven't already, sorry if I missed the episode that you did, is that this show really seems to try and get the 18th century Scottish gender norms right. It's definitely patriarchal with a lowercase p, but the women aren't doormats either. The heroine is a courageous, strong female character, but from the non-feminist 1940s. Gender-wise, there's lots to analyze in the show, just saying. Have anybody here heard of this show? Have any of you guys heard of it? It's called
vaguely, but I haven't gotten to watch it yet.
I've heard of it, and I just have no interest in it. It sounds honestly kind of boring.
Okay.
Well, I hadn't heard of it and haven't watched it, but personally, I don't want to adopt the feminist label patriarchy for gender roles, where basically men do all the hard work, and women's labor is divided usually into the home, which, of course, back then the work was quite a bit harder than it is today. I don't think it's patriarchal to put women's safety first.
No. Even with a lowercase p.
Yeah, not even with a lowercase p. I think that would be best referred to as gynocentrism.
Yeah, I wonder when they, because the person who wrote this is saying that 1743 supposedly got the Scottish gender norms right, but I wonder if it really did, because often with television, you have a bit of revisionist history going on.
Well, in 1740,
it's a Starz channel, which is like HBO, but not HBO. It's one of those channels where you pay for it. So they would have more ability to do realism and focus on minutia. So it probably makes sense, and what the person's saying is accurate. But yeah.
Yeah, they'd have to depict things like a huge disparity in privileges as far as work and things like that are concerned between wealthier women or more upper class women and common women, because common women actually in the that would have been 18th century, common women were working in coal mines in Europe. And common mm-hmm. women actually worked pretty hard. They did whatever they could because at the time their families couldn't survive without them doing that. Whole families would go to work in the mines. And, yeah. I mean, there were other jobs like that. There were jobs that, still jobs even then, that women didn't do. And you didn't see a lot of women on the battlefield. But there were jobs that today are thought of as having always been traditionally male jobs that actually were not.
Hmm. Yeah, that's what I would like to see. That would be really refreshing.
Well, the book series is written by a woman who's Roman Catholic and got, like, a Bachelor of Science in Zoology.
Huh. Zoology.
That's interesting.
Yeah, that
she
is.
She should know quite a bit about the fauna of Europe.
Yeah.
All right.
So I doubt that she's, like, a hardcore feminist or anything.
Mm. Yeah, no.
No, it doesn't sound like it, but I guess you have to see. All right, so here's another letter. Eric Hamel, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, or Hamel, writes, "Hey Badgers, would you consider doing a show on Extant? I've been a fan since it debuted last summer, and it struck me that some of its central themes are similar to those in Xenospora." I don't know what this is. Is it Extant? I have no idea. Does anybody in the chat know what Extant is? And does anybody on the show know?
I think it's the CBS TV series with Halle Berry that isn't very good.
Oh.
I don't. They could be talking about something else, but that's the only thing I can think of that's called Extant.
Yeah, that's probably. I mean, you're probably right.
Here's a Wikipedia article about it.
It's like TV, so I don't really pay a lot of attention to TV shows.
I don't pay attention to CBS.
Okay. All right, so the last letter. This one should be fun. Filter021 has made an inquiry. "Hi, Badgers. Thank you for reading my post about the show Humans, and I love your take on this show that I had not considered. Since Gamergate has celebrated its year anniversary, I was wondering who would you cast in the Gamergate movie. Here is my dream cast: Chris Pine as Internet Aristocrat, Matt Smith as Milo Yiannopoulos, Andrew Garfield as Sargon of Akkad, Chris Pratt as Jonathan McIntosh, and Lindsay Lohan to play Zoe Quinn."
Oh my goodness.
I'd love to hear your dream cast. Okay. You guys want to take a minute to like look at this? I like casting things, so.
Okay. I think Meryl Streep's got to be base mom, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Seems obvious.
Yeah. There you are. There
no, are. No, yeah. No, either that or Helen Mirren or something.
Yeah, something like
that. Be in it. I want to see Tilda Swinton in it.
Okay.
You could play a guy.
We should let's get all the classical British actors or something.
Let's look at the picks that Filter021 chose. So, Chris.
I just found something in my armpit that can play Anita.
There we go. And Dr. Randomerkam as himself.
Yes. Written and directed and starring. Like the
Eddie Murphy of the Gamergate. All right, so he casted Chris Pine as Internet Aristocrat. I don't know. I like Chris Pine, but you need somebody who really sounds like he's in constant troll mode when he's talking, and I don't know that Chris Pine does that. I might have cast, say, Ryan Reynolds, or maybe even Dane Cook or something. That's be somebody.
Really?
Who's
really?
Not Dane Cook!
Being douchey?
You'll kill us all.
But Internet Aristocrat is actually a lot smarter than, I don't know, than these people come off.
The actor is irrelevant when you're casting for a movie.
I'm just saying, you know, they would have to.
Or we could go, like, completely SJW in our casting and cast people as people of different races, ethnicities, genders, and sexual orientation.
Okay, then Sam Jackson's playing me.
Yeah.
So, if we're going to do that, then Oliver can be played by Christina Applegate.
Master Chief Potter has it right. The Rock should play everyone.
Yeah, that's right. And Vin Diesel. Because if you...
Vin Diesel as Mike Cernovich. Yeah,
Vin Diesel as Mike Cernovich, right. Family. Family. And if anyone complains, we get to call them shitlords.
I say cast complete unknowns.
Yeah, there you go. And then play it overly dramatic, melodramatic shit. Like,
all right, let me see what people in the chat are casting, because I think this is pretty funny shit.
Biotic Warlock said Maggie Smith is Rachel.
Andrew Garfield does not have Sargon's gravitas. Well, Andrew Garfield is like a windsock of a man. That's not right at all.
I love Andrew Garfield.
Like, we need to resurrect Brian Blessed, and then he should do it. Idris Elba as Oliver.
Michael J. Fox is Brianna Wu. I don't know why that's so funny.
That's perfect. Or the guy who played Doc Brown. I forget his name. Up.
Oh, God.
You make a great
Christopher Lloyd.
Weird Al Yankovic.
Lloyd, yeah.
Jennifer Lopez.
Weird Al Yankovic should play Nefenora Crawl.
Hayden Christensen as Mundane Matt.
Oh, no. No, he'll kill us if he's listening to this.
Jabba the Hutt as Anita.
Dane Cook should only play people that you want to have die at the end. Okay, I will.
Oh, God, who's that actress from Parks and Recreation who just speaks in monotone all the time? She should be in.
Audrey
something.
Audrey,
yeah, something like that. She
somebody
should
wrote.
Like,
wait, Denzel, the real
listen and believe, everybody.
Denzel Washington as Milo.
Danny Trejo as Brianna Wu. Al Pacino as Brianna
somebody
Wu.
Wrote, in the chat, head desk, motherfucker! That's Samuel
Sean Astin as Jonathan McIntosh.
Nick Cage as McIntosh. Everyone wants to cast McIntosh for some reason. Mike Cernovich would totally go for that. Yes, I agree. Jennifer Lopez as Vox Day. John Connery as...
Shut up to pee, man, if you do this.
Oh, job. These are great. These are great. Nick Cage as... Woo. Wait, woo, Nick Cage?
Actually, you know what? Actually, that would work. Nicolas Cage in, like, drag?
Yeah, he totally looks like
Brianna Wu.
Brianna Wu would be the role of a lifetime.
Dude, that's like the Patrick Stewart casting of Professor X. Putting Nicolas Cage as Brianna Wu, that's beautiful.
It should be directed by the guy who directed The Room.
Jackie Chan as Anita Sarkeesian. Louis C.
What?
Dogs. Yes. Miley Cyrus as Zoe Quinn. Everybody's got ideas. I can't even keep up. Lori Penny as Lori Penny.
okay, but who would play who would
the real game developer?
Who would play literally blue though? What's her name? You know
literally
what I mean.
Dortmund, though. She gets cut out of the script.
Oh, Adam Baldwin as an internet aristocrat.
How about Alec Baldwin as Adam Baldwin?
Alec Baldwin as Adam Baldwin. Yes.
Or one of the lesser known Baldwins, maybe.
Jonathan's trying to speak.
I was just saying, what about Robert Englund as the father in Family Ties?
Or we could just have John Cena play everybody. Chuck Norris is Kevin Strong.
Oh, gosh. Neil Patrick Harris is Milo Yiannopoulos.
Ice Cube as the cameo role of Ice-T. Louis C.K. as every man giant.
Oh, that's beautiful.
A table sponge as Zoe Quinn. Because she has a lot of holes that need to be filled.
Oh.
No, but who would play Randy Harper? Like, we need somebody terrible.
The chick that turned into the blueberry in the Willy Wonka movie remake. And they could just use the same makeup.
The Corny Weaver as Hannah, I like that.
And this wombat over here as Randy Harper. This
wombat. The trash heap from the Fraggles as Zoe Quinn.
Oh, shit. No one's casting Otter Jesus.
Wait, hold on. I'm trying to think. Somebody.
Eddie Murphy plays everybody.
I'm trying to think of an actor that seems cuddly enough to play you, Otter.
Or just be an animal actor.
Or done by CGI.
Played by a real otter.
Eddie Izzard. Oh yeah, we could have a Muppet play Otter Jesus.
There you go.
That would be perfect.
Well, the guy who did Smeagol can like do a motion capture.
But who would play Michael Kretsky? Who would play Kretsky? What's your name? What's his name? Kretsky from SPJ.
He could play himself.
Billy Crystal.
No.
Mel Gibson as Sarah Nyberg. Oh.
Felicia Day as Will Wheaton and Will Wheaton as Felicia Day.
There we go.
Andy Serkis could play me.
Andy Serkis, yes, exactly.
I like to pronounce it Serkis because it sounds funny.
And then we can just see the making of the film where he's just kind of crawling around on the ground pretending to be an otter in the motion capture suit.
Kermit, and he's
kind of like, oh, hi, everybody, it's Otter Jesus.
Ness says that Kermit the Frog is going to play you.
the software that animated Gollum as Brianna Wu.
Matt Damon as...
This is going to go on forever.
Yeah, we got
it. I know.
Bill Cosby as Sarah Nyberg. All right. that's awful. Okay. Capaldi as Dr. Ranemerkamp. All right, so, Peter Capaldi, let's get into that's the last of the mailbags. If you guys have any other brilliant casting choices for the Gamergate movie, put them in the comment section. I think that would be great. And let's go into the thing. Hold on, where's my thing at? All right. So we're going to be discussing horror film and memoriam of the recent passing of Wes Craven, who is a horror film icon, and you guys probably know who he is, otherwise you wouldn't be here watching this. But also, it's Dario Argento's birthday today. I believe that Dario Argento did zombie films in Italy, the Italian ones, you know?
Did a lot of movies.
Yeah, he did a lot of movies, but I mean, like, I think the thing that he's best known for is the films called Zombie, where it's zombie movies with nails going.
No, that was Fulci, dude. No, dude, that was Fulci. That was Lucio Fulci.
Oh, I'm sorry. all right, so let me do the reading that I threw together real quick. So, Wes Craven, Last House on the Left, The Hills Have Eyes, A Nightmare on Elm Street, Scream. These are some of the better-known works of horror icon Wes Craven. Wes Craven was born part of a Baptist family and was forbidden from watching any film at all, save for Disney animated films. This, of course, made him curious about the kinds of films that he was not allowed to see, even to the point that one day he snuck out of his house in order to watch To Kill a Mockingbird. Upon seeing that film, he questioned the reasoning behind his parents' decision to prevent him and his siblings from being exposed to movies. This and his experiences with his parents' constant fighting and arguing acted as a catalyst and inspiration for such films as The Last House on the Left and The Hills Have Eyes. Nightmare on Elm Street was inspired by the idea of dreams as part of the human experience as well as a personal frightening encounter with a random stranger he saw as a child. He even included some psychological elements dealing with color theory in order to design Freddy's iconic look. And lastly, with the Scream franchise, he was looking to break the fourth wall in order to try and bring the fear of the other into the real world, where horror movie tropes are used as an inspiration and catalyst for real horror acts. Ironically, if Craven had never experienced his troubled childhood, he likely would never have given us the films that he is best known for. Okay, that's it. You guys have any thoughts about Wes Craven? I know Otter has some stuff he wanted to say.
I'll let some of you go first so I can collect my thoughts because I don't have my meth.
Okay. Well, I'll expand on some of this stuff. So, like, the story behind Freddy is pretty interesting. So, Wes Craven said that once as a young boy, he lived in a second-story apartment building, and he looked out his window and saw a man, wearing a hat and looking kind of like what Freddy Krueger looks like, wandering about, probably a drunk or something, and it was really late at night. And he was wandering down the street, kind of stumbling. And for whatever reason, Wes Craven was kind of fixated on this guy walking down the street. And the man stopped and looked, made eye contact with him from the street to the window where he was. Which, of course, frightened him because he didn't expect that the man would notice his gaze. This scared the shit out of him, and as a boy, he ran to his bed, and he waited a while, assuming the man had left, and he went back to the window and looked, and the man was still staring at him and smiling. So young Wes Craven went to his brother and said, "Oh my God, there's a man, he's coming to get me." He was probably like 7 or 8 years old at this point, maybe younger, and his brother grabbed the baseball bat, and they went downstairs to see, and the man was gone. So what stood out for Wes Craven was that there was this idea that there were people that not only were scary to children, but liked scaring children. They liked to, they got joy out of it. And so Freddy Krueger came out of that idea in terms of the visual, like the personality and the look. On top of that, he added the reason why he had the glove with the knives on it was a reference to what Wes Craven believed to be the most primal form of danger, or, like the earliest weapons, which is essentially like the claws of an animal. So, he thought of like a claw of a bear and basically made that into something a man would use that would make it much scarier. And then lastly, as far as the colors go, I thought this was really interesting. The sweater, which is red and green, is striped. That idea comes from, he was looking at color theory to find out which colors are the most sort of like disturbing for the human eye, and that when they're on next to each other, and it's red and green because they're complements, so they kind of vibrate. And, that's basically the concept behind it. And yeah, Freddy Krueger is the original fedora wearing shitlord, which is pretty true. So I don't know, but he also, like the other movies too, Last House on the Left was basically his first movie. I don't know if you guys know this. It's been remade, but one of the things that's really interesting about it is that when Craven filmed those movies, specifically Last House and Hills Have Eyes, he was thinking about ways not only in which to make the mundane into something really kind of scary and dangerous, which is the idea of, in Last House you have like these wandering drifters that like rape this woman and it's all very visceral. But he also took inspiration from things like documentary filming, which is the sort of like the style he adopted for that movie, and the idea of not turning the camera away, which is something that before in horror film was relatively common practice, where you wouldn't see, the actual acts because you were kind of like made to imagine it, but he showed it to you. There are sort of different theories as to whether or not that's the best practice. I think that it varies, but that was his approach. And also, he didn't really have, he didn't stick hard to the scripts in films like The Last House on the Left. He actually allowed people to do a lot of improvisation when that movie was shot. So when one of the best parts about Last House on the Left, the original one, I'm not sure because I didn't see the remake, there's a scene where all of the people had just raped this one girl, and I believe they killed her, they'd beaten her, and she's laying in the grass covered in mud and her own blood and injury, and she's sort of like, recovering, and these people who had just done this are picking like the, grass and dirt and stuff out of their fingernails and like very sort of casually, because it's kind of a long, it's a scene that plays out for a long period of time. And then there's a moment where they realize what they had just done. Like they lost their humanity while that was going. And there's like a moment of regret on what they had just done, which is also kind of something that you don't really see often in those earlier movies. Okay, Auto Jesus, go ahead.
Specifically about Last House on the Left, I felt like that is his weakest film because there's not really a plot to it, but it was really his way of getting attention, and that helped him build a career. But like I just really do not like that movie. But Wes Craven has this interesting viewpoint towards horror, where like there are all these different serial killer movies, like Halloween, Jason movies, whatever. But the villains or whatever are kind of like the main characters, but there's nothing about them that's really interesting besides the way they murder people. With Nightmare on Elm Street, with Freddy Krueger, he made a character that had a personality and had more to him than just, I'm just going to murder people. Because he did what he was doing specifically in a unique way, like with murdering in their dreams. And this is kind of going to be rambling a little bit about just Wes Craven, but another thing about him as a director and a storyteller is he never just lets his characters, his heroines or heroes or whatever, he never just lets them sit there and be menaced. They always fight back. They always fight back. They figure out ideas of what to do to protect themselves. In Nightmare on Elm Street, she sets up traps for Freddy at the very end. And she, plans it. And even in Last House on the Left, the characters fight back. And the Scream movies, they always fight back. It's just something so distinct about him that you don't necessarily see in other movies, like Halloween. It's like, oh, I'm scared, I'm going to hide. And that's what they're doing in those movies. They never really truly fight back until, the very end or something. But, yeah, his characters are always really strong in terms of that. Like, the female characters are never victims, necessarily. They are... They're characters who are fighting back. I always like that about his movies. I lost my train of thought now.
No, it's fine. We got time. You can always chime back in when you think of something else. Rachel?
Well, actually, I was watching the remake of Last House on the Left, and the reason why that kind of counts is because it was still produced by Wes Craven. Even though it was a remake and it wasn't directed by him, he was still producing on it and working on it a bit. But basically, I disagree that it has no plot. The whole idea of it is that you have what is being portrayed as sort of this virginal girl, at least in the remake, and she's just, in the prime of adolescence kind of thing, and she makes one stupid mistake after being advised by her parents, like, oh, no, you can't stay out late. She's like, oh, no, I'm just going to go stay with my best friend, somewhere. But really what happened is she went off with a boy, like a stranger, and they went off and they smoked pot. And then, but what she doesn't know is that really all of the people who are with the boy, like his dad and all these really weird drifters, are like really evil people, and they've just committed a crime. And they find that those two girls that have been brought back to this hotel room are a liability, and now they're like, oh, we're going to teach you a lesson for bringing these girls back here and risking our lives, and because now we're going to go torture them and shit. So it's really kind of messed up, but the whole idea is that it's playing around with the idea of, your parents are telling you, don't do this sort of thing because you might be in danger and you need to be careful and stuff like that. And it plays upon the fear of parents, and that it's basically what horror tends to do, which is explore the worst case scenario of every situation. What can go wrong will go wrong in this particular situation. It's the fear that things will go wrong in a way that you cannot even imagine. But yeah.
I just want to clarify really quick. I didn't mean that it had no plot. It just didn't have a very well-structured, complex plot. That's what I meant.
It's fine.
I would say, yeah, it is pretty simple, but the thing is, sometimes things are genius in their simplicity. Mm-hmm. Because this is just kind of a common fear that everybody has. about what's going to happen to their children or what might happen to me as a young, innocent teenager.
I think that what makes that why it might stand out that way is because, you know, I think at the time that the film Last House on the Left was made, there weren't really films like that, so that was really new. But if you were to remaking that today, it would be, or even seeing it later after a lot of other movies that have sort of played on similar themes, like say The Hitchhiker, for example, where you take a situation that begins mundane and then things escalate and they get really out of hand and really terrifying because you have these characters that you are, like in theory, you are attached to, and they're put into seemingly hopeless situations or really dangerous situations. And I think that that's why The Last House on the Left works, regardless of the fact that its plot is not that, you know, it's not really a deep plot. It's just like, you have people who wander into, essentially, they have a bad encounter.
That's very cerebral.
Yeah, and that's the thing about what I was going to mention about specifically with Last House and with The Hills Have Eyes as just two examples. It's not really clear that, I mean, there is a clear villain and there are clear protagonists, but you get to know the antagonist in a way where it's not as black and white. Like with The Last House, you know that those kids, those people that do those terrible things are not good people. But then there, in the beginning, it's played pretty straight. And then after the incident, then you start thinking, oh shit, these people didn't really want to do that. Or there's something else going on here. And then by the end, the family that was being attacked, when they retaliate, they become as bad in their own way. They basically become the monster that they're fighting against. And yeah, that is a really kind of interesting and cool twist on it. It's not that it says that the family is suddenly not good, but considering that Wes Craven himself grew up in a very, very structured Baptist family that was really religious, and they had lots of rules, and they were very family-oriented, and he was very clearly rebellious, you know, in many ways from the beginning. I think that that's sort of him exploring that, you know, that dark side of family. So that I find really interesting. Oh, Jonathan, did you want to make a comment?
Well, like, I've never watched that movie itself, and I can see that when I did a search on it that there was actually two versions. One and two. The first one was 1972, and then there's the 2009. Which one are you talking about? Like, are you talking about the 1972 one? Is there a difference between the two?
Well, Wes Craven directed the 1972 one. It was remade in 2009, and actually the 2009 one is the one that Rachel saw, and I believe that one is actually much gorier, and it has a more messed up ending. I'll put it that way. So, like, the father
did weird
fucked up shit to those guys.
Weird about the remake, though, is the director was like, I want to try to not make it torture porn. It's like, okay.
Yeah. And the thing is, too, is that when the remake happens, the remake happens, and you get this, you feel like there's justice happening when the villains get their comeuppance. In the original one, you feel like that there's a balance that happens, but it's sort of like, you know, that there's a scarring too. Like, it's not as easy to get revenge in the original film. It's a little bit more like, oh man, it's terrible that they had to do that, you know. But in the remake, it's more like, yeah, give it to them. It's a little bit of a different emotional, outcome for the remake. But the remake was produced by Wes Craven, not directed, although that just means he kind of signed off on it and said this is okay. So, yeah. But I wanted to. That's right, Hannah. I think that was. I'm going to get to that. So I want to ask some questions. All right. So, as far as horror films go, one of the things that you notice is a very common thing with horror movies. Is the protagonists are often, especially during the 80s, 90s, and probably today, they are often teenagers. They're often the victims, and they're often the protagonists. Why do you guys think that teenagers are the way to go in terms of horror movie protagonists? Hannah?
Because in a lot of ways, it's your target audience. Teenagers are the ones that go to movies, like, on their own. Parents are not going to take little kids to a horror movie, unless they're really bad parents. And for the most part, as people get older, like, some couples will go to horror movies and everything, but teenagers have their own sort of specific reasons for going to horror movies, and they're more likely to want to stay up late night telling each other scary stories and, you know, and so on. They're the ones that have spent years going to camps when they were younger and telling each other campfire stories. And it's being a teenager is sort of a unique time in your life to enjoy the deliciousness of being scared half to death in the dark with a bunch of your friends around to share the experience. So that's my theory on that, is they're making it more sympathetic to the target audience.
Okay. Rachel?
I would almost say that, not necessarily sympathetic, I would actually say that to some degree it satirizes its target audience. You see, so often they poke fun at the problems that the current youth are having, that there's, you know, the frustrations perhaps that adults have with the newer generation being all presented and satirized, you know, and exploited, pretty much. It's kind of, and by exploited, I mean, they're exploiting the vices of the youth. Like, just, it has a tendency to happen again and again in films, that they're just, like, early on, if you think about it, what happened to teenagers in the movies, like, I'm trying to think what era, but, you know, the kind, like, the 50s, maybe. And they were all like, you know, they were parked and stuff like that, and they off on a hill or something, and they'd be like making out and be like, oh, what was that sound? It's, you know, they came out there for sex to basically fool around, and then they became the victim of their own, you know,
yeah,
of their own vices. And that's an ongoing theme, is that the teens are becoming victims of their own vices. That's often caused either by just human nature, or you know, or just what happens when you're young and stupid.
Okay.
So it's, I don't know. Kind of a cautionary tale to some degree.
Yeah, I think so. It sort of like reminds you of old grim fairy tales, you know. Jonathan?
Well, I just kind of see it as kind of like when I was younger, I was into horror movies and that, but. I'm not much into it now because I don't like the modern horror movies as much. I see them very sadomasochistic and just very perverse. But anyway, I see it more like kind of like a rite of passage. You know, you're now at the age where you can see the stuff that you couldn't see before. And not to mention, if you take someone on a date and that you're both scared together, it has a kind of a bonding effect.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. OJ?
One thing, like, about that, like, that's how horror movies were for a long time. There are still, like, remnants of that strain of horror film, and then there's always going to be the really violent stuff that's not scary, it's not horror, it's just violent. I mean, like, there's the Saw movies, some people say the first one's different than the rest. I don't care. And they're, like, the Final Destination movies where it's just about murdering people in interesting ways. That's not horror, because that's not... That's just murder. That's murder films. I call that the murder genre. But with horror films, they have a cerebral element to it. And also, there's a lot of horror films end up tapping into spirituality more than people realize. There's the director, Scott Derrickson. He's a Christian. His horror films... and even his non-horror films, but his horror films, they always end up dealing with spirituality in interesting ways, and it's really interesting to see that. Like, basically, horror films are kind of like a genre that is very spiritual compared to everything else. If that makes sense.
But, yeah.
Yeah. I feel like we're in a golden age of horror films again, because for a long time it was just recycling stuff and not doing anything original and just trying to push the envelope and making horror movies more violent or more adult or whatever. But in the last, I don't know how many years, horror movies have finally started going into a direction where they actually care about, like, the people making them are caring about the story within the movie and not just, is it going to scare people? So, Blumhouse, the studio behind, like, the Insidious films and Sinister and Paranormal Activity, I think they're involved with that, too. Yeah, something like that. Anyways, and then there's Guillermo del Toro, who has produced three films that are horror films, basically about motherhood. There was Mama. There was that remake of that old TV movie with a I can't remember what it was. Are you Afraid of the Dark? I think, or Don't Be Afraid of the Dark or something. Mm-hmm. And then there was Splice, which was more of a science fiction film, but it was still horror, and it dealing with these elements like motherhood and then taking it and turning it into like introspective, and I don't know what I'm saying.
No, you're
point. It's so rich and like horror films don't actually have to scare you necessarily. The only horror film that's ever scared me was Gremlins, because that movie's terrifying for a young child who ended up having nightmares forever about it. But it's like if a horror film doesn't scare you, that doesn't mean that it's bad. It just means that it didn't scare you. But if the horror film actually had more to it besides jumpy, then and it doesn't scare you, then examine the film and the plot. Because it's like a drama. Is a drama bad if it doesn't make you cry? Is a comedy bad if it doesn't make you laugh out loud until you cry? I don't know what I'm saying.
Well, that's a good question. I mean, I think it just depends on the goal of what you're making. Like, you can have a good movie that failed to be a horror movie, but it was a good movie. I mean, I think that's possible. Well, here's a really good example. The original Evil Dead was supposed to be a horror movie, and Sam Raimi, essentially, when it showed, everyone laughed in the theater, and they loved it, but it did not get the desired effect that he wanted. So when he made Evil Dead 2, he went and just said, fuck it, I'm just going to run with it. I'm going to make it as ridiculous as possible. Yes, I will have gore and violence and some horror aspects, you know, but for the most part, my goal is to entertain, you know, people. And I don't think that people find Evil Dead 2 or Evil Dead or Army of Darkness scary.
Or Drag Me to Hell.
Yeah, I don't think they're scary movies. Or even Drag Me to Hell. It's kind of, you know, there's some jump scares in it, but after a while, jump scares, I think if you see them enough times in enough movies, they lose all of their punch, you know, after a while.
I feel like he just wasn't really good at making horror films and good at making any films, so he just makes them funny.
Well, that which is ironic because he really likes the horror genre, but he also has a fondness for a certain kind of filmmaking, a certain kind of effects. Like, he likes practical effects, he likes models, he likes stop-motion animation. He loves that stuff, and he uses it as often as possible. It's reminiscent of another director who likes old, sort of silver screen, you know, golden age filmmaking.
Peter Jackson?
No, I was thinking about Stephen Sommers, but that's probably another good example, too, because Stephen Sommers made the Mummy movies, and he made Van Helsing, and those
I
movies...
like Van Helsing.
No, I like Van Helsing too. I mean, I think they're fun, you know, but they're not scary. Like,
well, yeah,
the Mummy
I didn't
has
think...
some creepy moments in it, but you know,
I thought the Mummy and Van Helsing were adventure films. I didn't think they were horror.
That's the thing. That's what he was trying to make a movie based on the old Universal Studios monsters, mm-hmm. because he was working at Universal Studios and wanted to do it. But his passion, what he does well, is tied to making these adventure kind of Errol Flynn, you know, epic type films. That was the stuff that he liked. So he included those kinds of stories in his movies. And so that's why a lot of people say, you know, The Mummy is basically you know, an Egyptian Raiders of the Lost Ark, because but that's what Stephen Sommers likes, you know. So that's it's. But so my point is, a movie that even if it was may have had its roots in horror, does not have to be a good horror movie to be a good movie. It just fails at being a horror movie. That's all.
Okay. So a movie that's clearly a horror film that doesn't scare you, is that still a horror film?
I think it can. I think you could make the argument that it's not. I think you could say that it may have been intended to be a horror movie, but I mean, what makes a horror movie if it doesn't scare you? Does it need monsters?
Because what if other people are scared by the movie?
Well, then maybe that's subjective, or maybe you can say it fails as a horror movie.
Not everyone cries when they watch The Notebook, I'm sure.
Right. I was thinking about something else. Some movies, like Ghostbusters, you know, like a really little kid might find Ghostbusters scary because there are some ghosts in it, and if you're superstitious, you might find that scary. But if you get to a certain age, you'll find Ghostbusters to be a really great action comedy.
Well, like, they're the ghosts in Ghostbusters, you wouldn't be scared by them because of superstition. You'd be scared by them because some of them are really spooky looking.
Yeah, like the librarian.
In the beginning.
Yeah.
The librarian, exactly.
With Gremlins, one of the reasons why that the first one, it scared me as a child, and, like, okay, it's a comedy, obviously. But originally, it was a straight horror film. There were scenes where, like, the mom gets killed and her head is thrown down the stairs.
Yep.
Yeah, that's horrifying.
It's messed up.
And okay, they changed it because they're like, this isn't going to be as marketable.
Yeah. I'm going to give the floor to Jonathan, and then I'm going to ask another question. Jonathan, go ahead.
I was just going to say that, I remember watching the documentary about Wes Craven, and they did with his interview. They asked him. Well, he mentioned that when he was doing all these films, he had all this fame because of Nightmare on Elm Street and all that kind of stuff. But he said that within Hollywood itself, they referred to him, "Oh, you're that horror guy. You create horror movies, so you don't make real movies, you know." So there was this kind of bias. And at the time when he was entering into the whole horror genre, horror movies at the time, they were all just gore fests. Chopping people up with, you know, hatchets and all that kind of stuff. So when you kind of look at that in context and you see the kind of movies that he created that were horror ones, it was like he was trying to kind of like make it legitimate by actually creating fleshed out characters that fight back, that, you know, you can root for and all that kind of thing. So
yeah, no, there was definitely some snobbery in Hollywood when it comes to that kind of stuff. Now
there kind of is.
Oh, there still is, totally. So let me. I want to make a couple of other points about horror movies as a general topic that maybe we can go into. And, you know, I think that Wes Craven was one of the pioneers of changing the game in terms of how to do horror. But so horror movies have been around since we've had film. It was like one of the first ones I think we made was a Frankenstein film that was a silent movie way, way back in the day. And it didn't do very well because, well, maybe the culture wasn't ready for it or whatever. Oh, Rachel, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to skip you. Go ahead.
Well, one thing I was going to talk about is that there are different varieties of horror film, and I feel like there are very few films, horror films, I think that are good movies. There are many that are, you know, going to scare you and everything like that, but how many of them are, you know, just stick out to you as like really, really great movies? So I understand, I guess, the snobbery, because there will be a ton of movies where they'll just use, you know, cheap scares and stuff like that. Just very lazy writing. But I think the great films play on things that scare everybody. Just fundamental primal fears that everybody deals with. Every single person deals with. And I'm trying to think one of the ones that was really scary to me. The last one that I watched that was really, really disturbing, that just got to me, was a film called Funny Games. And it's actually a remake, I think, of another film that I didn't watch. But basically it's the idea you've got this family. And this family is, you know, they're going on vacation and they've, you know, this is their time off. And of course, you're like, okay, cool, whatever. But then they meet these seemingly really, really nice guys who are clean-cut, like really, really rich, upper-crusty folks. You know what I mean? They're wearing like the golf outfits and everything like that, and you're like, oh, okay, they just wandered off the golf course. But they're both really massively sadistic fucks, and they proceed to play a whole bunch of mind games with the entire family that are meant to eventually take each one out one by one.
Yeah.
And it's just, and the most horrifying stuff that happens, you never actually see. It happens just out of sight. And it's always this play on sounds. Those are the things that are always scary. It's not what you're seeing, it's the sound. You may not actually see anything, but it's the sound of what is taking place that you remember. And it kind of plays back. I mean, that's one thing that you find victims of violence and or really, really intense situations. There's always a sound that they associate with that particular violence. And when you have these people who are suffering PTSD, sometimes they will hear that sound. And so I think that is the thing that really plays up on. A lot of people miss the opportunity to play with all the senses. And they just, you know, do a bunch of the jump out scares. So it's truly good horror. Play is a commentary on humanity itself. The state of human beings and what it means to be a human. Life and death.
Simply. Yeah. Well, I want to go to a little bit of the history of horror film. But I think that for me, what makes a really good horror film is that you have to have an element that cannot be comprehended. So you can't understand. Either you don't know that, you know, humans are capable of doing something, or that there's something that you don't have a clear understanding of. It's the unknown is the scariest thing, because, of course, in our own minds, we make it a lot worse. So if you don't see something, or you don't understand something, or you can't comprehend why something is happening, that makes it terrifying. And I think that that's what a really good, scary movie has, where it doesn't explain a whole lot, or it doesn't show you too much, or it leaves enough out and leaves things to the imagination, because no budget that exists in any Hollywood or, you know, global film industry can possibly match what the imagination is capable of doing. And if you can harness that as a director, then you have something. You know, that's how you make really good horror. That's how you get, you know, to, especially as people get older and they become more skeptical and they become more cynical. With children, it's not as hard, but with adults, it's a lot more difficult. Jonathan?
Oh, like I put in the chat there. the freakiest movie of all of them that really freaked me out was Communion. The one, the book that was written by Lee Strasberg or whatever, it was supposed to be based on a true story, but it deals with the unknown. It's to do with alien abduction, and the way they shot that whole movie was like really freaky and all that. So, but it's a psychological thriller, and you don't know what's real, what's not. You're kind of going into the mind of Whitley or whatever, and it also deals with the unknown, like you were saying.
Yeah. Doesn't it star Christopher Walken?
Yeah, which is one of my favorite actors. So
he's so good.
So good. Out of Jesus, you want to say something?
Yeah, I can't remember what it was. Oh, it was something, but I can't remember. Right. Anyways, I don't know.
I'll go ahead.
Oh, I just wanted to say Alfred Hitchcock, and that was all.
Oh, okay, yeah, Hitchcock. Well, he's good at taking, because with, like, for example, The Birds, he took something that we take for granted and made it into a threat.
I love that movie, but I wish they'd remake it and base it off the actual novella.
Yeah, well, I mean, that would be, or even Psycho, which I think is, that was like a first. I mean, he went into places that the culture would not dare go at that time.
And what's interesting about that is, like, the whole, like, what you don't see is what gets you. even in the scene where she's in the shower, there's no nudity at all. But you think you see nudity.
Well, yeah, there's a voyeuristic thing that happens.
Yeah.
And especially, because you got to imagine, being alive and watching that movie at the time the movie was out, where something like that was completely unheard of. Now, we live in a time that is, you know, well beyond that. So this, we take that kind of experience for granted, you know, when you think about it. Like, back then, people like that were pioneering the way that they, essentially pushing the envelope. And Hitchcock was one of the guys who did it, you know, all the time. And he was always raising the bar and trying new things, and no one knew what they were going to get. And so when you think about Psycho, that was something that, I mean, that was, I can't even conceive of it, because when they remade Psycho, nobody cared, because we'd already, like, you know, it's like, so what? We've seen movies that have done that and much more, not like better necessarily, but that idea of showing you, you know, blood, violence, stabbings, nudity, you know, all of those things that are kind of like, they were considered pretty taboo at the time that they were being explored during Psycho, or even cross-dressing and stuff, which is, you know, and mental illness, all of those things that they were exploring in the movie Psycho, that sort of stuff that we don't care about. Like, you can watch Silence of the Lambs, you know. And
that is why, that's why the remake was so terrible, because it was literally just, they remade the film exactly.
Well, there's almost no way to explore those themes again, because the culture has shifted so much. The generation.
Remade the film. It's like, why remake the film? Why, if you were going to remake it, change it and try to modernize it? They literally just made the same movie.
This was not a movie you could have improved on. It would have ruined it. Trying to change it would have ruined it. They should have just left it alone.
Yeah,
there's some people, classics that should just be, because it really, really was a first, to the point where, if I remember right from what I've read, people actually got up and left from the first screening because it freaked them out.
Yeah, the it's a product of its time, and sometimes watching it that way, it just makes it, you know. All right, so I'm going to go a little bit. So in the history, I'm looking at the history of horror movies real quick. So, like, we had, in the early parts, right, the first thing that we got into were, essentially, they were monster movies. We retold, like, these Victorian classics. We had Dracula and Frankenstein and the Wolfman and all that. And they were essentially taking these sort of, you know, English story, European stories, and making them into film. And then they started getting into, like, exploiting those things, you know? So you started seeing movies like Dracula versus the Wolfman. And it wasn't even a monster movie anymore. But, like, when you think about it, a movie like Nosferatu or the original Dracula, if you watched it now, you could appreciate it for other things, like the way it was shot, or maybe, you know, how they were managing to do the things they did with what they had at the time. You could appreciate it for those reasons, but I don't think it's going to keep anyone up at night. And as films evolved and changed over the years, they had to keep upping the ante and, like, finding new ways to scare people. And it might have something to do with the fact that maybe, I mean, humans, we adapt to stuff so quickly that stuff that we found scary in the 1970s, we don't find scary anymore. Now, maybe that's just because I'm older, and maybe it only affects me that way, but it seems like we keep, you know, getting to the point where we can't find a new way to scare people, so we have to just make things more absurdly violent, or, you know, we have to find a new way to, like, you know, create scares, or we find that one movie succeeds in doing something, and then all the directors jump on that, and they try to replicate that stuff. You know, well, like, when
people in general have a tendency to jump on trends. So when somebody does something and it turns out to be popular, it turns out to resonate with people, other people will explore that thing in their own way and stick with that thing, especially if they're trying to make a profit on what they're doing, which movies they may be designed to entertain, but they got to make some kind of a profit or they're not considered a success. And so they'll continue on that sort of that trend until somebody comes along and does something new. And as far as as far as some of the stuff that sort of seems new in what Craven did. A lot of it had to do, from what I noticed, a lot of it had to do with sort of restoring the tendency to use suspense over other things necessarily. So you're actually pulling your viewer into the character's emotional state again, and it's not just, you know, vomiting gore at people. You're actually engaging the individual's fear again, and that's like, in a way, that's kind of pulling from Hitchcock. But yeah, the trend thing is probably one of the bigger reasons why movies will go on a tangent like that, where it's getting a little more gory, a little less suspenseful, a little more gory, a little less suspenseful, and it just keeps going like that.
Yeah, and then someone has to come in and kind of reset it. Like when, I'll let you talk in a second, but when Wes Craven came out with Last House on the Left, which was his first movie, I believe, or at least one of his earliest ones. Yeah, I believe it was his first. He was going against the grain, because at that time, all of the horror films were just really gory exploitation movies that were just trying as hard as possible to be, you know, include as much nudity, as much sex, as much blood and gore and dismemberment as they possibly could, which was essentially it tumbled there from movies like Psycho, because Psycho came out and you had like a murder in it and it was considered bloody, and then other movies were trying to play off that Psycho trend. Like, I think there's one called Who Killed Lady Jane or something like that that came after that, and it just kept kind of like upping the ante in the violent perspective, and they were missing the point, you know, and then they kind of got to a point where it was just about exploitation and spending as little money as possible to create as much shock as possible. So when Wes Craven came out with Last House on the Left, he was taking stuff that sort of like thematically was happening similar, where you had human beings as the other, but he was putting a twist on it to try to immerse the viewers into, like, they could feel like that could be them that's on the receiving end of that violence, as opposed to them being, oh, you know, this is just so that I can see all this blood and stuff. Outer Jesus.
Yeah, like, I said this in the group chat a little bit ago, but Wes Craven kind of came in and tried to fix horror without intentionally doing it. He tried to fix horror multiple times, and he kind of succeeded until everyone just started copying what he did. And then
Because people jump on trends, right? So when he does it, he sees other people try to do it too.
Like with sort of like with Nightmare on Elm Street a little bit. It wasn't as much, but he was making a villain and a horror film that was more than just watch the person go kill people. It was about, like, more than that. It wasn't just really simple. And even with Last House on the Left, he was doing, what, like you were just saying. And then with Scream, well, he didn't write the script, but he clearly worked with the writer on the script and the later movies. Those movies are clearly kind of comedies, but they're also they have suspense in them. There's amazing sequences of suspense within those films. But the movies were actually looking at horror films and going, okay, all the stuff that is metastasized within the genre is cancer. We need to examine it, and they did. So yeah,
you're talking about Scream specifically,
yeah,
right?
And even with New Nightmare, he kind of did that, examine the genre of horror as more than just movies. He made it about this primal thing, which Joss Whedon and Drew Goddard? I can't remember. What they sort of examined with The Cabin in the Woods, where I won't get into it for people who haven't watched it, even though you should have, because it's a good movie. Ignore Joss Whedon. It was directed by somebody else. It's just, like, examining the genre of horror has become now a more interesting trend than just going, it's horror, look at this person killing. Like, there's ghosts, and they're demons. No, don't do that. Actually create a story, like Exorcist. Exorcist had like an actual plot to it, where that movie did not scare me at all, but it made me cry, because seeing this family go through this, that was really upsetting. So, yeah.
Well, and I mean, like, I'm going to give this to Rachel, but I mean that you're, what you're making, the point you're making with Exorcist, how it didn't scare you, you're a younger guy, right? I know you're younger than I am. So, like, when The Exorcist came out, the reason why I'm saying this is this. Mm-hmm. When The Exorcist came out, the idea that a girl that young and that pure could be the victim of something that she could not stop or control was beyond comprehension. Like, no one would think that you could do that. That was off limits. And they did it in that movie. And so at that time, for those people, the people who were alive at that time, that was why it was scary, because they were like, oh shit, I thought that you couldn't kill anyone younger than a teenager or an adult, because like in the 50s when they were making monster movies, it was mostly adults in those films that were, you know, being threatened by monsters. And teenagers came out like as we went into like the slasher movies or the horror movies of the 70s and 80s, but The Exorcist, the girl was so young and she was possessed by the devil and her personality changed a great deal.
Not the devil, Pazuzu.
What? Yep.
It was Pazuzu, not the devil.
Pazuzu. Right. Oh, yeah, right. But I mean, like, the idea that you could do that at that time was unheard of.
Okay. I thought that, like, it terrified my mom. It scares my brother. It doesn't bother me, though. But part of the reason why a lot of people were scared by it was because of there are a lot of people who believe that that's possible to happen. Like, that demons exist and that people can be possessed. And Christians were like, this is spooky because I know that this can happen. So that was, I'd never heard the explanation that, oh, it was a little girl, and so that's why it was scary. Mm-hmm. Although they did change their actual, like, true story from a little boy to a little girl. Can't remember if that was intentionally to make it creepier, but, yeah, I don't know. But, like, it still scares people, but it didn't scare me. So...
I could see how it probably would be. I think that the only thing more vulnerable in our culture than a little boy is a little girl. Rachel.
Yeah, and I agree. Like, I had a similar situation with the allergies had, because I remember watching The Exorcist, and I was not scared at all. And I don't think it's really just a sign of the times either, or even that it was unheard of. I think really what has happened... And this is something that I've noticed, is that they really, really started, I don't know, they really started taking away the idea of unsanitized fairy tales. The folk tales that people used to tell each other were far more hardcore than some of the stuff that we're seeing on screen now. Now you do some of the stuff that people have been talking about in folklore for years, and you put that on screen, that's really fucking edgy. But we have removed the cautionary tale, and that's why I think horror continues to be such a thing in our culture, because they are our modern cautionary tales that used to exist. Because usually, what a cautionary tale was meant to do is that you see these things, and then eventually, it makes you more prepared to deal with something like that when you're in that situation. It gives you a lesson. It makes you. It helps you to explore things that you might not have thought about that you were doing, that might make you vulnerable and things like that. And so, the situation with The Exorcist is that the reason why I think it's not so scary is that it entirely relies on you believing. First off, being, you know, I guess to some degree religious, and secondly, believing that it's possible that people can be possessed. And so it entirely hinges on that being the case. Kind of like The Omen. The Omen relies on that heavily, but the only thing that beyond that that makes it scary is the fact that it's a child. It's the fear that maybe a child is perhaps not nearly as vulnerable as you would expect. But if I had to choose something that actually did have a little bit of a that was a little bit scary, that had a younger protagonist, it was Pan's Labyrinth, and it was because it was actually meant. It was actually structured like a modern, well, not so modern, but like a fairy tale was, like the old school horrific fairy tales were, where there was so much unknown to you. There's a whole bunch of bizarre things taking place that you didn't necessarily understand, and the whole story is structured around this girl who's she's concerned about her mother, and of course there is some things there about the unknown in pregnancy, but the majority of it is that you have this girl and she's going to this unknown place with this unknown man who's supposed to be her new father and everything like that, and just all of these things beyond her control, being entirely powerless in this situation, and then finally having the opportunity to maybe help in some way, but having to go through these different labors, having to carry out these tasks that were very, very dangerous. And the scene that got me was the one where she's going down, I can't remember why she was there, but she goes into this room, and there's a table full of food, and there's this creepy motherfucker with no eyes.
On his hands, though.
Yeah, they're on his hands.
Well, they're on a plate, and then he puts them in his hands. She's there to get tea.
Or something. Yeah. And she's got to go get the key. And what I remember, I was watching the commentary on it, and he structured the monster to be like a man who had once been very, very fat, but had lost a lot of weight very, very suddenly. So possibly from starvation. And that was the concept behind this guy. Yeah. And there's something entirely unsettling about it, that he would forever have this food in front of him, but be unable to touch it. Sort of deal.
Right. Otto Jesus. Oh, I'm sorry, Rachel, are you done?
Yeah, I'm done for now.
Okay. Otto Jesus.
I can't remember what I was going to say.
Okay. Hannah?
Well, my thought as far as The Exorcist requiring you to believe in order to be scary, I think it's more of an issue of suspension of disbelief. But the things that were scary about The Exorcist were not just specifically the fact or the insinuation of the existence of a demon and having it take over. It's a number of things. It has in common with Poltergeist that situation for the family that the most vulnerable member of their family, the youngest kid, is going through this terribly threatening ordeal that she will not survive without help, and the parents are helpless to save the kid. The parents can't do anything about that. Mm-hmm. Because they don't have the expertise. They don't know what they're dealing with. The thing they're dealing with is something that ordinary people don't understand. And the other thing that it is horrifying about it is very similar to like the older vampire movies and the vampire legends and everything, with the idea that there is this nefarious evil taint that is seeking a method to get inside of the protagonist. That this is something that draws on an old human fear. The fear of being stalked by the unknown and of losing yourself and becoming something evil or tainted, or in some way or another losing your self-control to the point where you will commit acts that you would find taboo or otherwise something not do. And where vampires used to play on that, they're nothing compared to demons from hell. As opposed to, I guess vampires are also considered a form of demon, but at least in some genres, this portrays that horrifying aspect of a thing looking for a weak spot so that it can invade and take away your control over yourself and make you into something that you find horrible and would not, you wouldn't want your family interacting with, and you wouldn't want that to be the face that you present to the world. So it's not just a matter of the religious aspect is scary, and it adds an element of fear because you get possessed by a demon, you lose your immortal soul, or you lose your potential salvation if you don't get rid of the demon. But even without believing in heaven and hell and evil and good and all of that in the way that particularly in the way that religious people do, those other aspects are still horrifying aspects. I mean, that movie, I was under 12 when I saw that. I wasn't supposed to be watching it. But, well, you know, it scared the crap out of me. I mean, it's one of a small handful of movies that has actually influenced my nightmares. So, and then that was the aspect of it, was that horrifying thing taking over because it found a weak spot, a way in, and then not being able to control your actions, not being in charge of yourself. That's like one of the most terrifying ideas that you could present to me.
Mm. Yeah, I can see that. I also think that in a way, our society has become a little bit is more secular than it used to be, and sometimes the hysteria of other people, because if you think about, like, we had a lot of stuff that dealt with hell and the devil and stuff around that time, like Rosemary's Baby, like The Omen, like The Exorcist.
Yeah, The Omen. Now, yeah. The Omen added an aspect too, because here you have a situation where you are in the presence of an evil that other people don't recognize for what it is, and you're forced to interact with it and be around it and tolerate it, and you can't do anything necessarily about it. That is a large part of the horror aspect of The Omen. The additional influence, you know, the innocence of a child and how that plays into it just makes it even more horrifying.
Otter Jesus, go ahead.
Okay, so when Rachel was talking about the folktales and stuff, I wanted to make the point that, like what I was saying before, where, like, horror films deal with spirituality and sometimes even theology. Most of the folktales back then were actually made, like, thought up by Christians and like Catholics and all that stuff. So it's interesting to see how that continues to, but I don't know. I thought that made sense. Did it make sense?
No, it does make sense.
Okay. But yeah, it's interesting how that, like, and then Disney comes along and, like, let's not make them horror. But then Disney makes horror films anyways, because those movies are terrifying. Little Mermaid? Oh, man. Well,
ironically, as you know, as I said in my my write-up, Wes Craven was only allowed to watch Disney movies.
Yeah. And
he had to...
That's hilarious.
Sneak out of his house on one day and go see To Kill a Mockingbird, and when he did, he had this amazing revelation where he was like, what the fuck? Like, why am I not allowed to watch movies like this? And it just made him hungrier for more media. Okay, Rachel, go ahead.
Okay, I will say, I do have a perfect horror film. And I will say, and I'll tell you why. And it actually does have to do with the whole, religion, like, belief in the devil, that sort of shit like that. But that's not the horrifying aspect of it. Rosemary's Baby. And you might think to yourself, okay, well, this is playing on the fear of giving birth. But actually, if you think about it, the whole movie is actually about loneliness. The whole film is really where it begins. This mundane feeling of loneliness. You have this woman, and you know she and her husband are, you know, they're newlyweds. They're moving into this building that's unknown to them. It's really old. They don't know anybody there in the city, really. And her husband is an actor, and he's trying to work up in the world and things like that. But for the most part, she is a housewife, and she's by herself all the time. And so when she starts, it's that fear of who might be there around you. It's that sort of sense of paranoia and the feeling that maybe, and that's the thing, the whole thing is kind of fucking with her mind. Rosemary is wondering whether or not she is losing her mind, or whether or not the things that is taking place is actually happening. So she's either crazy, or there's some kind of weird satanic cult that is doing something that she can't quite explain, and all the people she tries to go to for help are in on it. mm-hmm. some degree. So it's that feeling of absolute powerlessness and being alone in yourself and having to deal with something as stressful as childbirth or a failing relationship all by yourself in a place that is that makes you uneasy or is uncomfortable. So it's
so yeah. Now yeah, so like Rosemary's Baby, that's what is what like let we I mean that's a great movie. I think that it's also about something else because at that time there was all this there was a lot of talk about My Body, My Choice and abortion stuff. Do you think that Rosemary's Baby was making a commentary about women's bodies and, you know, childbirth and their ability to give abortions and things like that? Do you think that that might be relevant? Can you see those themes? Anybody who's seen that movie?
I don't think that movie was political. I think it was purely targeting the horror aspect. I really don't think that it was intended as a political statement. I'm sure people could get political theory out of it or relate to it on a political level, but honestly it was too well made to as a horror movie to be. That's not the right way to say what I'm trying to say. It was too much of what it was. It was too
pure
to really be. There would have been, even though there wouldn't necessarily have been a direct mention, there would have been something that you could look at and say, well, this is a dead giveaway, and there really wasn't.
Right. And I think that it is made way scarier when, you know, to imagine yourself. I think that horror films are slightly more aimed at women because I think that women tend to, you know, I think they can be scared more, and guys like to take women to the movies, and horror movies are a good thing to take girls too. So they target them because it's good date material. And if you're a woman watching a movie about a woman who is giving birth to, you know, is getting involved with a cult and potentially giving birth to the devil to bring about the apocalypse, there's a lot of scary stuff there that I think is uniquely feminine. And even as a man, I mean, I can find how scary that is.
Well, what's so creepy about that is that her husband is like going behind her back and making deals, and part of the deals for him to have a good career or whatever is, oh yeah, and your wife gets pregnant with Satan.
Yeah, with Satan's baby. And the scariest thing about all that, the scariest fucking thing about that is the feeling that every single person is against you, and you're not sure whether or not you're just paranoid or
the
not.
The sense of conspiracy and the sense of being gaslighted.
Exactly. Because every single person she approaches with this, and the thing about it is because the whole premise, the very idea of this is so batshit crazy that everyone's going to look at you and say, sweetheart, I think, you know, this is just the pregnancy hormones getting into your head or something, or something's going on here. I think, you know, maybe you need to get some help kind of thing.
That's
everybody's
kind of
being patronizing to her.
That's kind of a thing that you go through when you're pregnant. Everybody knows that your hormones are out of whack. Everybody knows that you're more emotional than normal. Even if it's not true, everybody knows it, because that's common knowledge that pregnant women are more emotional. Pregnant women, their hormones are out of whack. And so the same thing happens to pregnant women that happens to mental health patients in general, where your thoughts and your feelings and your interests and everything, if they conflict with other people's thoughts and feelings and interests in any way, it becomes attributed to your mental state instead of to the factors involved. And so, say, for instance, if you're not getting enough sleep because of a circumstance in your home, and you try to talk about the circumstance, everybody will turn it around on you, and it's, you know, oh, well, you're just upset, you know, you just need to relax, it's you're not getting, and if you're overstressed, you shouldn't be so stressed when you're pregnant. That kind of thing happens to almost every pregnant woman, and so they probably just any woman that's been pregnant and then watches Rosemary's Baby is going to be like, I know how that feels. Maybe not to that extent, but I know how that feels.
Right.
And there's that sense of identifying with the protagonist again, where you're sort of your target audience. And for that movie, one of the target audiences there is going to be moms.
Yeah. Just like Alien.
I was just going to mention Alien, which is all about...
Sometimes every mom feels like her child is the spawn of the devil, too, so, you know.
Yeah.
I remember giving birth to Satan. Whoa, man.
Now, a lot of horror movies, they played off of... They did use things, the sign of the times, in some ways to, you know, to sort of sell it, to make their mark. And I think that's one of the reasons why some movies, either because... The culture at the time was different, or maybe the way that our society was at the time in terms of its position, and like maybe the threat of war and, you know, nuclear devastation, all of those things often played into what popular or the most well-known horror movies of the time were. For example, I was asking about Rosemary's Baby because I was curious about like what you guys felt about that, but this is, I think, a really interesting thing. In the 1950s, there was a movie called The Thing from Outer Space, and essentially what it was there was a thing that lived amongst these guys in this frozen north, you know, sort of military base or whatever. And at that time, it worked for the time. That movie was remade later by John Carpenter, and it was just called The Thing. And The Thing is one of my favorite John Carpenter movies, if not my favorite, but I think it's second to Big Trouble in Little China. But anyway, The Thing is really good, but he basically gave it a new sort of look, because what worked for The Thing from Outer Space did not work as well for The Thing, which came later. Because, and one of the things that makes The Thing, The Thing from Another World, I'm sorry, you're right. It's not The Thing from Outer Space. It's The Thing from Another World. Thank you, Otter Jesus. So, but what made it work really well was when he made The Thing, he was doing... he was playing off of this paranoia of one of the men was the alien. And they all, there was like... you had these guys that were really close-knit at first. And then once the invasion begins, as it were... they start to really like pull apart from each other, and there's a lot of mistrust, and even by the time that, this is the best thing about The Thing, when the movie's over, you still don't know what if the alien is alive or not. You don't know, like, it's left ambiguous purposefully, so you're still asking yourself, how did this end? What is happening? How? And you feel as though these guys are working with they're basically at a disadvantage from the moment it begins. They don't know what they're dealing with. They don't have the appropriate supplies. They're running low on stuff, you know, and that's what makes that so great. It's so desperate from the word go. Jonathan?
Oh, I was just going to just add to that whole Thing movie that Aliens is another movie that would be based just like The Thing was, where you don't know who's infested with this alien thing in it, and if it's going to attack you or whatnot. So it's just about the other.
Yeah, pretty much. And how it lives in all of us. So it's like there's... John Carpenter was talking about what makes good horror, and one of the things that he said was very common was this idea of creating an other... That, you know, you had your tribe, and then the enemy, the thing you're supposed to be afraid of, is the other, which is, you know, out there.
But the commies.
Yeah, whatever it is, the commies, which I was going to mention.
The red.
I was going to mention that. But John Carpenter believed that, it, for him anyway, the best way to do it is that it's not, the enemy is not out there, but it's inside of us. Like, we're, you know, it's what humans are capable of. It's, like, within us. And that's, in his opinion, it's more difficult to do, but it's a more, it's got a bigger payoff, you know. And that's a good example. That is what you were mentioning, Otter, in the chat, which I was going to mention, was Invasion of the Body Snatchers. So when the first Invasion of the Body Snatchers, it was remade later, but the original one was done in the 1950s. And I think, I mean, like, they don't really make it clear, they don't really say it, but essentially it's about things like, conforming and all that, but I think that ultimately what it was the Red Scare or communism. There was this fear of communists, and the Invasion of the Body Snatchers was an allegory to that. And it worked really well at that time. I don't know that it would work so well today. Because, I mean, I like that movie for what it is, but I don't know that it would hold up in the same way.
Well, the latest Invasion of the Body Snatchers movie ended up not doing well, and it was partly because there wasn't really a clear... The movie didn't make a clear excuse for it to be scary, because it didn't connect with anything. And it was a good film, basically. It just didn't really have a connection with the culture at the time.
You're talking about the remake, right?
There was like three.
The one that had
The Invasion.
Donald Sutherland in it.
I'm talking about the one in 2007. Mm-hmm. That was just called The Invasion. The Wachowskis were brought in to rewrite stuff, and then the third Wachowski brother, James McTeague, ended up reshooting it, and it was a box office. Anyways, never mind.
Okay. Hannah was going to say something. I'm going to let her talk. Hannah?
Just really briefly, it could be redone if they related it to a more modern threat like terrorism. They would have to change the way the body snatchers acted significantly in order to actually make it work now.
But if they did it about terrorism, would that not be a non-PC thing to do?
Oh, of course it would be non-PC.
Yeah, but very much so. Like, we could do communists, that's fine, back then.
Yeah.
But we can't do that now.
But I think it would be successful, nonetheless.
Yeah.
Terrorism is starting to get a little bit old.
I think that would be a good allegory. You'd have to analyze terrorism and find out what... how you could, you know, so that people feel like it feels familiar without it being them being told this is terrorism.
You wouldn't necessarily know who the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers, once they were the majority, they let everybody know who they were. In this situation, they might not. You know, in a more modern making of it, they might not necessarily. And you wouldn't know until they did something, until they committed an act of terror. And then, you know, some group of them will come forward and take credit for it.
Yeah. All right, Jonathan?
Well, I was just going to tack on something else that would kind of refer to the other. That 1971 movie, The Andromeda Strain. So the idea is that there's this strain of virus that was taken off of a meteorite or an asteroid or something that fell down to Earth and all that stuff, and it's being analyzed, and they're busy shipping it off, and they're going to use a train service in that, and in the process, it gets out because one of the workers on the train or whatever is curious to know what this armed guard or whatever that he's supposed to, you know, bring this thing to the lab or whatever, what he's hiding or whatever. So he goes into the car and then he snoops around in that and he breaks one of the vials. It gets out and he contacts it. And when you get this virus, if you fall asleep, it takes hold and it causes your brain to explode. So you have to stay awake as long as possible.
Whoa.
Yeah. And it drives people crazy in that. And everybody, you know, is under quarantine at the train station. They can't get out. And there's this interplay between the relationships between the people. And so if you haven't seen it, check it out, because it's one of my favorite kind of older movies.
What did you think of the miniseries? Did you never see it?
I didn't know there was a miniseries.
It was done on A&E a while ago.
Oh, I just remember the movie, Andromeda Strain, but then there was a second movie that came out as well. And I think it was called The Alpha Incident.
Yeah, films about viruses, those can be pretty interesting too. I mean, that kind of goes into zombie movies too. But that's pretty interesting stuff. Andromeda Strain. Exploding Brains, all right.
Michael Crichton for the win.
Rachel.
Well, I wanted to mention my favorite horror film, and this is just... I don't know if some people will even want to call it horror, but I think I think it does count for horror, and I'll explain why. It's Let the Right One In, which is actually a Swedish film, but there's no fucking social justice bullshit in there. So it's I think it almost makes up for a lot of stuff, because it's a beautiful movie. Don't fucking cut corners and watch the remake. Watch the original with subtitles, because it's a masterpiece. And the reason why I want to say that this is horror, because most people would see this, the fact that there's a vampire in it, and say to themselves, okay, the vampire is the bad person, the vampire is the other, the vampire is the thing that's supposed to be scary. And yeah, granted, yes, the vampire Ellie is kind of fucking scary, but if you really think about it, the thing that's really scary in it is what it does really well is it depicts being a young child who's being heavily bullied really, really well. And that's really the scary thing, is that you are afraid that someone is, you know, you feel essentially helpless. Like, no one is coming for you, and you don't feel like you can tell anybody about it, and you're just kind of boxed in on all sides, and there's no one on your side. And that's really what this story plays on, is you're trying to figure out who is using whom, who is really the villain here, and what's taking place. Because by the end, you are genuinely scared for Oscar, because you understand everything, but you understand what's taking place here. You understand the weird parasitic relationships that everybody kind of ends up in. And it's I don't want to give too much away, because I think people should really give it a watch. But I think it's really a fantastic film, and the cinematography is amazing. Like, every shot is like an art piece. So it's moving art. It really is.
No, Let the Right One In is a really good movie. I liked it a lot.
I liked the American version. That was not a remake. It was actually just another adaptation of the book.
Okay, there are moments where it's shot for shot, dude.
I wasn't scared by the... I didn't even watch the remake. I mean, I don't see the need when you could just...
I thought it was really good. It was a well-made film.
I'm sure it's good. When I learned that there's an original version, I watched the original version.
Ew.
If it's foreign or whatever. And if it turns out that people tell me that the remake is better, or that it's significantly different but good in its own way, then I'll watch it. But if it's just a remake... like Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, I see no reason to watch the original version of that film when there's three perfectly good movies already. So, but that's just me. Anyway, one thing I was gonna say is we gotta wrap it up. And horror is such a gigantic genre. Horror movies get made every year, and most of them are garbage. And I think that, and also you have to consider, because Jonathan mentioned earlier, that there's a bit of snobbery. There's snobbery in Hollywood when it comes to genres like horror and comedy. I think that horror and comedy are two of the most difficult genres of film to make. Not just because Hollywood is snobbery, you know, it's snobby towards it, but I think it's because it's just difficult to do. I mean, like, comedy is immensely difficult. Anyone who is a comedian will always tell you that. It's very hard to do comedy, because you have to do something that appeals to, you know, in order for it to be successful, as to appeal to a lot of people and be genuinely funny and remain fresh, and you have to compete with everyone else. I think that horror is very similar, because I think that people have a tendency to adapt to situations, to, you know, horror in the same way that they do to humor. So, question is, this is for the panel, what do you guys think makes for a really good horror movie, in short? What elements would a good horror movie need to have? Or what would it need to not have? Like, what would you need to take out? I'll ask Otter Jesus first. And it's just your opinion. I mean, like, I'm not asking, you know, like, whatever. What is it to you?
What horror films are to me?
What makes them good? Like, what makes a good one?
A good horror film is a movie that's approached like any film, but it just deals with horrific elements.
Okay.
So if you're approaching the movie like, let's make the movie spooky, and then you just have people get murdered and things and blood and big boobs flying through the screen that were cut off. What? No, I'll stop there. But, yeah, like, that's not horror. That's just garbage.
Mm-hmm. Jonathan?
Well, me personally, I think a good horror movie, I guess I'm kind of old school, but like Oddities said before, we've kind of gone full circle on the whole, you know, horror movie thing where we went back into where just a big splatter fest, but now they're actually putting more content, a real story and characters that you're rooting for in there. So that to me is what they should stick with. I mean, I would have more psychological elements and I'd have way less gore in it. Let my own imagination kind of fill in the blanks, and so that's what I'd have in it.
Yeah. I would say, I'll just go ahead and say what I think before I go on to the next person. I would say that a really good horror movie has characters and situations that we culturally find extremely unpleasant or distasteful. So when you see things happening to children, that makes us all unnerved. When there are things that happen that we cannot understand, or we put characters in a situation that they have no hope of controlling, and then there is something coming for them that we don't have a full grasp of, and the idea that something would happen to these people or these characters is very distasteful in the larger framework of the story, I think that that's what makes a really good horror film. For example, I think that The Ring is a good example of that. Because there's uncomfortable things happening with this child that no one, you know, can really relate to, and there's like this impending doom that's coming, and this woman has to like figure out how to stop this unstoppable thing, you know, from coming for her coming for her child. In Guillermo del Toro often puts children in danger in his movies, and that's why I think it makes his movies so much better, because he's willing to go there. I mean, in the movie Mimic, he kills a couple kids, and that's really messed up, as well as Pan's Labyrinth. I won't give anything away, but there's some stuff in Pan's Labyrinth that's really fucked up. So if our society finds it distasteful, and there's a sense that you don't have control over the situation, and there's an unknown element, I think that those are the best things about horror. Hannah?
I'm going to go with things that should be removed, because we've pretty much established what should be there. Making gore the focus of the film instead of an aspect of the film is one of the problems, I think, with a lot of modern horror. And it was a tangent that horror kind of went on in the 70s and 80s, and it came back from that a little bit. And then, you know, you get into the movies like House of a Thousand Corpses and stuff like that. You've just gone right back into it. And it's, you have to have that ability to relate to the protagonist. You have to have the ability to sort of feel the scenarios that they're put in. And when it gets to the point where it is just nothing but interesting ways to kill people, and how much special effects can we put into this to show blood? How many different ways can we show blood in this movie? It takes a lot away from the movie. And it just becomes sort of a, I would call it gore porn, as opposed to a horror flick. It's not really scary. It's just a way of triggering your disgust instead of triggering your horror. And it's, I don't know, it's just not the same.
Yeah.
The suspense is important.
Build up, build up, build up. Tension.
Yeah.
Mr. Mike, you've been silent the entire show.
Yeah, I get distracted by things. I think the answer's horror. No, something horrible. Something horrific. Well, you know, what makes a normal horror film is horror. But what makes it good is surprise, I guess. You know, just like what makes a comedy is humor, but what makes it good is surprise, because surprise is what's funny, and surprise is what's scary. Like, you don't have to scream at a film for it to be a horror film. You don't have to laugh at a comedy film for it to be funny. But it's the element that that surprises you, that pushes you out of the thing you were expecting of this genre. Is that a basic enough answer?
Yeah, no, that's good.
I mean, I sound like I've been paying attention?
When you say that, do you mean, you don't mean like a jump scare, like where the camera slowly creeps up on the door and then something...
No, I mean, you have an expectation, and that expectation is confounded either slowly or, well, yeah, whatever.
Suddenly, what a twist.
Okay. Yeah, it's something that takes the zeitgeist where you expect it to go and then go somewhere else with it.
Yeah, that's good. Jonathan?
One word, Creepshow.
Yeah. Well, I like the Creepshow movie. I don't know, is it scary though? When you say Creepshow,
somebody took you out to go swimming in a pond and you looked around and you were like, holy shit, this looks exactly like the pond from Creepshow. Would you have difficulty getting in the water?
Yeah. Then if you're talking about the one from Creepshow 2 that had that, it was sort of like this oil spill thing that was eating everybody. Yeah.
Yeah.
Or how about in Creepshow 1 where there was the skit, it was about the crate? Remember that one?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That was pretty cool.
Well, that's the unknown, right?
Would you have trouble sitting in a room with that crate?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, that's what makes it. It's a horror movie. Then, that's a scary movie.
Yeah, because you don't know what's in the box. What's in the box?
It's just like people today look at movies, old movies like Poltergeist, which isn't really all that old. It's the 80s, and they're like, oh, that wasn't that scary. But can you watch that movie, and then go look in the mirror, go in the bathroom and look in the mirror without having all the lights on?
Yeah. See, the reason why I like Creepshow is because they managed to pull off comedy and scary at the same time without it looking actually really goofy. I mean, it's a bit of both, but it's not like it's slapstick or anything. It actually is kind of freaky at times in that, but there's some funny
elements. That's like Poltergeist did. You know, like at the end of Poltergeist when they pushed the TV out of the hotel room.
Yes, that's very funny. That's a very funny bit. And it's almost like because it's relatable, like the audience is sitting there saying, that's what I would have done.
Yeah.
I think head desking is funny and scary at the same time.
That's just the concussion talking, Mike.
It will be.
For anyone who's worried, I appear to be fine. It's a week on, and
you appear to be fine. That's the whole thing.
Yes. Well, that's all right. But we'll just wait for the twist.
But I was gonna say what I think.
I was just gonna Rachel. I was just gonna give you the floor officially. But go ahead.
I just crept in there, didn't I?
Yeah. No, that's fine.
Spooky.
Slide right in there.
Yeah, just let it. Okay, anyway, what I think is the thing that makes a good horror film is, a good horror film doesn't insult your intelligence. I think that there are a lot of films that are trying to put themselves forward as being intelligent by being really fucking meta about the whole thing. They're like, oh yeah, well, we're breaking down the formula right here and we're talking about it. No, like, you don't have to fucking do any of that. A good horror film that just, you know, fucking shows you. It doesn't have to spill a single drop of blood. It does, like what Jonathan was talking about, I think, earlier, or was it someone else? Anyway, where, you know, it lets you fill in the blanks with your own mind. You don't have to even see every part of it. And it plays on things that have always scared people. Always, regardless of culture. And it just resonates with you because it'll always be there. That's why Jaws still manages to scare the shit out of people, because it plays on... I mean, it's an essentially bloodless film, and you don't see the shark until the very end. It's the psychological aspect of you can't see anything. Most of the times that you go into the ocean, you can't see shit. The water is murky. Anything could be down there. Anything at all. And it's stuff like that that makes a really great horror film. It's stuff that will always be scary.
Jonathan?
Well, I was just going to add that, well, I mean, horror movies, they've also done things like make things that typically weren't seen as scary, at least for most people. Like, for instance, like made them scary now. Like, for instance, look what they've done to clowns. Now clowns are seen as this freaky thing. Think about it. You hire a clown. Now you don't want to hire a clown because now you're thinking the clowns are going to, like, murder or kill your children. Or things like leprechauns and other bizarre things like that. So
dolls.
Horror movies have also done that.
Like dolls. Yeah, yeah. I think that it's really sad. Clowns get a really bad rap now. Like, I mean, it's literally, I think, impossible to be a clown. Like, you can't even do that as a job unless you're going to work at a fucking haunted house.
Oh, no.
Stephen King is the it, huh? All float down here.
Well, yeah, like, just opposite effect.
Well, not just it. There was other movies like, wasn't there an alien clown killing one or whatever, where these aliens come down with a
killer clowns from outer space.
Yeah. There's a whole bunch of them.
Yeah, no, that was a thing.
But I don't think that was something that came from movies. I think that that was inspired in movies by people's real fears. To an extent, I mean, clowns are intended to be funny, and they, for the most part, they are. They're funny, and they're cute. They, you know, and do cool things, and they're exaggerated and everything. But if you're not ready the first time you see a clown, it can really freak you out. Because here is a person whose whole face just looks wrong. It's designed to, the makeup on the face is designed to make everything look all exaggerated and weird. And they're, you know, they usually paint something to make their eyebrows look too high, and they paint an exaggerated expression on their face and stuff like that. And it can, for like a little kid who has never seen anything like that before, it actually can be a pretty freaky experience the first time you see one, if you're not ready for it, you're not prepared, or you're surprised by it. You turn around and there's one behind you. And I think that's where a lot of, like, the phobia of clowns actually comes from, is that, you know, kids having those moments where they encounter a clown that they weren't expecting to see, and they've never seen one before, and, like, their first impression is just absolutely horrifying, and they're scared of clowns after that. You know, maybe if their parents don't handle it right, or maybe if they have a tendency to develop fears based on that experience and not be able to let them go. And, that's basically, I get kind of creeped out by not the scary looking clowns. Like, you can show me the clowns and clowns from outer, killer clowns from outer space, and it doesn't bother me at all. But the normal looking ones do. There's something that looks wrong to me about them, and it's probably because of that. And I wouldn't call it a phobia. I don't get scared to be in a room with them or anything like that, but I don't find them entertaining because of that.
It's like it's a person disguised as something else, and there's something about that. Like, they're hidden, even though they're in sight. So basically, Jonathan has confirmed that we fear, we have an irrational fear of clowns, dolls, and the Irish. So
yeah, I actually don't have any dolls in my house.
Also,
because of the movie Barbarella.
What was that, Otter?
Also, we have a fear of small people.
The Irish, yeah. That's what I said.
Not all Irish people are small. I'm talking about, like, just... There was a whole series of films about little tiny monster people.
Oh, you mean like Gremlins and shit?
Well, Gremlins kind of started it, and then there was, like, Ghoulies. The toilet people things.
Yeah, Ghoulies. And Chuds, and Dollman, and The Puppet Master, and...
The Leprechaun series, one of the finest film series of all time.
Which, Puppet Master?
No, Leprechaun.
Oh, Leprechaun.
One of the finest film series of all time. The latest one stars a WWE guy.
Wasn't there one where it took some like Leprechaun 3 in the hood or something like that?
There was one where he was in space.
Like, what the fuck is all up with that shit?
They didn't know what they were doing. They're just like,
God. Warwick Davis, it's time to stop.
It's just not doing it anymore.
At this point, you know, I don't know. Is Warwick Davis still the damn leprechaun, or is it somebody else?
No, the guy from the WWE who's like small. He plays a leprechaun. I mean, he plays a leprechaun in the WWE.
Okay, well, then explain. Okay, I think beyond like the first Chucky movie, it should have ended. You know what I mean? like the first Chucky movie, I think that was like it went on for fucking too long too.
There's a thing with these franchises, they go on forever and then they just become comedies. Just straight comedies. They're not
just
scary.
To make you look at your My Buddy, like from when you were a child. Like really strange, huh? It's like just My Buddy comedy. Just looks staring off into space, just staring into your soul.
Yeah. Genuinely creepy. We're gonna wrap this up, but before we do, are there any horror movies that you guys in the chat just, or you guys in the show, like my co-host, want to mention by name that we didn't? Just any that come to mind that you're just like, oh, that was a good movie. So we can just make some recommendations to people in the chat or people who might watch this later. No, nothing.
Well, Mama.
Yeah, we mentioned
The Shining.
No, The Shining's dumb.
Oh, no. What the fuck, dude?
The miniseries is good.
The Shining was one of the few times Hollywood did a really, really good job with a Stephen King movie.
Well, yeah, but Kubrick, it wasn't even that good.
Well, okay, what about... did somebody... Jonathan, were you going to say something? Jonathan, go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, of course, my favorite monsters are... Or monster is a werewolf, so I like what is it? American Werewolf in London.
Yes, American Werewolf in London.
That movie was awkward.
I thought it was American Werewolf in Paris. Some of that.
That was the sequel.
Well, there were two. They were both movies. Yeah.
Okay.
And The Howling. There was some good ones. You know, Jonathan, if you've never seen it, I don't know. I love the Hammer films, and because they're just fun. And there's a good Wolfman Hammer film. It's just so melodramatic and all that, so.
I like Teen Wolf. I'm just kidding.
I'll mention one that I really liked is In the Mouth of Madness with, it's basically the closest thing we've gotten to a Cthulhu horror movie.
I hated that movie.
And I really liked it. And it's Sam Neill. It's another one that moves kind of slow. It doesn't tell you a whole lot. It doesn't show you very much. And I really enjoyed it. I also really like Event Horizon, too.
I would have liked it more if they didn't rip their way out of the movie screen or book or whatever happened. It was so goofy. It's like, seriously? You're going to show this like this? Stop it. No. Stop. John Carpenter, no. And then he just goes on and makes terrible films and stops making movies.
The movie Zombie by Lucio Fulci, and that's Zombi. I mean, I think he's considered to be the father of modern gore, and he does it really well. And one of the things that he does that is worth mentioning is that he does use a lot of sound to create his horror films. So he's using most of your senses, playing on all of your fears, and sure that there's a lot in there that's a little bit cheesy. But it's not so much that it takes away from the rest of it being scary. So even though there's like a shark fighting a zombie, I mean it's...
We forgot Hellraiser.
Yeah, the Hellraiser.
Oh shit, yeah. Series.
I really liked Hellraiser Inferno. That was a good sequel.
You're like
that was one of the few times I actually got a book and read the book because of the movies.
I also really liked
the
Phantasm movies. I think those are really underrated, especially Phantasm 2. Phantasm 2, you don't even need to watch the other ones. Just watch Phantasm 2. It's really good. I love that movie. And you know what? To this day, I don't know how many of those they've made. They have not explained anything, and I love it for that. It's a mystery.
This may be really campy, but Kingdom of the Spiders.
Oh, well, I mean, if you have a thing against spiders, yeah, I could see that.
At the time that I saw that movie, I had reason to believe that I was very, very allergic to spider bites. And it was one of the creepiest ideas, just being overrun with them, being able to avoid them. My mom is very allergic, and so, you know, it's actually one of those things. They're actually a real threat at that whole household. So it was a particularly creepy movie to me, but the idea of having an entire town overrun with them like that is just, it's creepy. And I know that arachnophobia is a very common fear, too.
The Arachnophobia was a good movie.
Yeah, that was a good movie.
John?
Technically interesting.
I was just going to say that when you said Hellraiser and what was that other one?
Phantasm.
Oh, and Phantasm, I watched that one, and for years I had nightmares of it. So I reached my threshold for comfortable fear levels. It actually leaked into my dreams, and I would have nightmares about it. Like, the Nightmare on Elm Street, I had dreams about Freddy Krueger, but it was always where he was crawling down the driveway and I was always kicking him out. I had control. But when it came to those movies, I just had complete just nightmares of it. I was dreaming about, you know, Rubik's Cube, because it was the time period, you know, Rubik's Cube, and that was still fresh in my mind and all that stuff. And you solve this puzzle thing, and then this thing comes out, and chains pull you apart and stuff like that. And that, you know, people are like, it's like the sadomasochistic thing to the 20,000th degree. It was like, it was just too freaky.
Yeah, it was definitely like a BDSM thing going on in the Hellraiser movies.
A good zombie film is also The Horde, if only for the end. Like, that's kind of... The whole thing is kind of an interesting take, I think, on it all. Is that you've got a whole bunch of people who are just kind of... were previously fighting each other on a previous thing, and then suddenly there's a fucking zombie outbreak, and these two people who are these two groups of people who are trying to kill each other have to then work together to survive the whole situation. So.
Oh, The Mist. Really like that one too.
Oh, that was so good. I love that movie.
Yeah, there was a really, really good movie. Frank Darabont did it. Thomas Jane. Oh, that's really good. And I know it's my guilty pleasure, and because I'm a child of the 80s, I will always love this series. I love Friday the 13th. I don't care what anyone says. I know they're not scary. They are just fun fucking movies. I love Friday the
13th. Jason X?
Yeah.
Is that your favorite?
Jason X was awesome.
Won an Academy Award.
It was awesome.
See, like, there was this weird thing where, like, the farther the series went on, eventually they realized, okay, we have to just go to space.
Well, that's the same thing with Leprechaun in the Hood and the Nightmare on Elm Street movies. When you have, and Child's Play too, I mean, when you have these characters that start off as scary, after enough movies, the viewers get to know them. So they're not scary anymore. We're familiar with them now. So they just become, but we still like them. And they still have a fan base, so you would just end up making the movies for fun. And you have to just kind of, you have to make peace with that. I mean, Friday the 13th was never really scary unless you include the very first one, only because, again, there's a surprise where you don't know who's killing everyone. And
everyone knows it now if they've seen Scream.
If they've seen it, yeah. But
no, you've seen Scream, you know the surprise.
Yeah, you do. But again, at the time, that's what it was. But once the novelty of that wears off, people are not watching it for that anymore. They just want to find out how Jason is going to kill people, or how Freddy's going to kill people, or, you know, or whatever. So, all right. So, Jonathan, did you want to say something else?
I'm kind of like, you know, a kid of the 80s, so, you know, I like movies like, say, did you like the, were you a fan of the original Halloween movie series?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I like the one with the Halloween masks, and they're like melting in that.
That was Halloween 3. That was the one that actually had absolutely nothing to do with Michael Myers. It was a completely separate film.
Yeah, and I like that one.
Were trying to make it into a franchise of separate films, and that didn't work.
Yeah, I was going to say, it wasn't intended to be part of the Michael Myers story, but it was really interesting. Because the masks would break open, and there'd just be bugs inside and shit.
Yeah.
Isn't that what it, there was like all these insects. That was a big thing, was insects. Like, what was it Creepshow that had that little bit with the guy who was a germaphobe, and he lived in this little penthouse, and he hated bugs and roaches, and then by the end they got to him.
And he was a complete asshole, and and everybody hated him and all that stuff. Yeah.
Also, Braindead. Braindead is a good zombie film. The Horde is more of a guilty pleasure.
The Dead remake was really good.
But yeah, the Braindead is actually a great film. It's actually when Peter Jackson had a lower budget, and he was able to do. He was messing around with comedy gore, kind of things like that. So it's kind of a fun sort of movie. It does the comedy and the. It's less of a, I think, a horror film and more of a and more of a comedy, but it's still fun.
Yeah. All right, well, unless there's anything else anybody wants to add, I guess I'll just take us out. And I'll take that as a yes. Okay, so if you guys enjoyed the show, please and consider going to our website at honeybadgerbrigade.com. Also, consider donating to our Patreon, which I always forget what it is. So if anyone remembers, please save me from myself.
Patreon.com/honeybadgerradio.
Yeah, yes, thank you. Yeah, please consider doing that too. We like making this stuff. We want to be able to do more content. If you guys have any films that we didn't mention or anything that you think that we should see that maybe is kind of on the fringe or exists, you know, outside of the norm, you know, sort of like a little indie or unknown, please mention it in the comments. I know that we could easily go into a whole other thing when it comes to foreign horror movies, and that's a whole other... We could probably do a whole other show on that if we wanted to, but for now, we got to stop at some point. This show went on a little longer than normal. Thanks, guys, for coming and checking us out, and we will see you soon.
Boo!